Hey everybody, welcome to this week's episode of the Vesey Total Grassroots Football Podcast, brought to you by VO.co. We are a brand new podcast across the airwaves. We are talking to people across the country about their own little corner of grassroots football. We want to be a bit of a knowledge share. We want to help other people around the country supporting grassroots football. And today we have the esteemed Laina Tebbutt. I look at your name written down. I do this every time. Look at your name written down. I can never know how to actually pronounce it. But it's Laina Tebbutt from Coventry City Girls. Laina, how are you?
I'm very well indeed. Thank you, Gary. And you're not the only one that gets my name wrong. Good. I get called all sorts.
Yeah, my surname is Gumbleton, right? I mean, I sound like a hobbit from Middle Earth. But I've had Harry Hambleton. I've had a whole bunch of names. So I'm with you on that one, right? But let's crack straight in. So we want to talk about the female football clubs, the increasing participation, challenges, all that kind of stuff. So tell me a little bit about what you do specifically, and then we'll talk about the female side of it.
Okay, lovely. Well, thank you very much, first of all, for inviting me along to the podcast. It is my first podcast, and I hope that I do Coventry City Girls Football Club proud. So I'm Laina Tebbutt, as you've already mentioned. I'm chair of the Girls Football Club. I'm very proud to represent the teams. The club initially started off with only six teams. And since then, we've progressed and we've doubled that size. So we've now got 11 junior teams and one senior team.
Great. And what are the age ranges?
We have a youngest team of under nines going right through to senior football.
Great. And when did you first start, when were you first established?
Well, I'm not going to let too many secrets out, but let's just say I've been with the club 17 years, and that's okay. Probably the time that my daughter's been playing.
Amazing. And so you're the chair, and just so people that don't know what a chair does, what would a chair do? What's a day in the life of a chair of a grassroots club?
Well, it's certainly not a grand title. I do often say to people, the reason why I'm the chair is because everybody sits on me. So basically having... It's basically having overall responsibility and oversighting that we're taking the club to a new level. We're making sure that we've got the professional outlook that we want. And literally, you know, we are sort of the halfway point between a grassroots club and an academy. And I say we're halfway point. We're a really good grassroots football club, and we're very professional in what we do, not just with the images, but the way in we encourage the players. We coach the players, but we also support and invest within our coaches and our managers as well.
Love it. I love the confidence in it. So let's talk about the female game itself, right? I feel, and I think we all feel, maybe it's slightly underrepresented, right?
Oh, massively.
Yeah. And I think it need, you know, that of late, there's been more of an increase, but we could do with more. We all want more, right? I think, you know, it's not going to be done overnight. I think if we need to be honest with ourselves, that, you know, it's not going to be level with the men's game overnight, but we can do something every day to get it level, right? At least get the participation, the funding, the volunteers in amongst the female game. So how, over the only the couple of years that you've been in the industry as such, how have you seen the women's game grow?
The women's game has grown massively, and I think that's down to a couple of things. It's down to predominantly tournaments that have been streamed live on television.
Professional, you know,
the Lionesses, for example. Yeah, professional football. And that's given the girls the belief that football is not just for boys. And of course, with curriculums in schools now, they're also opening up footballs for girls as well.
Brilliant.
So it's had a massive impact on all of them. And certainly within our own club, we've seen the numbers that have come in, you know, in drones saying they want to come and play for us. And I'd love to support everybody. And I'd love to say, come on, girls, I'd love to have you all. But unfortunately, there comes a cutoff point. And I'll go into some of the frustrations later.
Yeah. Have you hit any challenges? Have you seen anything kind of like back in the day as to why it was stumped in growth?
Yeah, I think if you want to go back in time, back in the 1900s, boys' football was very prominent. I mean, if you look at the major manufacturing industries, for example, you know, like Jaguar, Dunlop, they produce male football teams, and therefore they produce football pitches for the guys to play on. And the boys have sort of had that history and had that development sort of passed on historically for them. Yet girls' football, we seem to fight for absolutely everything.
Yeah.
Pitches, you know, council. What grassroots female football owns their own ground?
Yeah.
Very few.
No, that's right. Yeah, it's normally on like the school's field, you know, with like jumpers for goalposts kind of stuff, right? Because it's down to funding. And but do you think, or from what I can assume, really, it's top down stuff, right? It's the professional teams that will obviously raise the exposure of the male or female game. Obviously, everyone focuses on the, you know, the men's team. Well, not everyone, but you know, there's a majority focus on the men's team. What have the Lionesses done for the women's game?
I think they've empowered girls and empowered women to believe that they can go out there and compete in a man's sport.
I agree. And do you know what? It's not even at a team level. Absolutely, there's like this exposure, right? There's awareness, being able to see the games on TV, being able to stream it live. You know, the attendance might be lesser, the sponsorship deals might be lesser, but the accessibility is getting better. There's a quality out there now, or at least a focus on bettering equality. But there's also individuals now as well. It's not just Harry Kane and Raheem Sterling, right? It's the actual individuals in the female team. And do you know what? As I say those two male football players, this is a perfect example. I would have trouble naming two female players.
Surely you know Alex Scott.
Sadly, I'd have trouble. I can do a move. You know, the viewers can't see this, or the listeners can't see this. I did put the owl eyes or whatever it is. But then that's part of the issue, right? But I think it's getting better. There are the individuals now that are raising the awareness, even punditry as well. I think they're getting way more. You know, do you know what I loved seeing in the Euros was the women's Chelsea manager. All of a sudden, she kind of popped out of nowhere and was a pundit and amongst Ian Wright and Frank Lampard, right?
Absolutely.
And she did a great job. She was brilliant. She was actually more honest. I felt she was definitely more honest. I felt it was actually really refreshing to see a brand new face and actually surprising. And the fact that they didn't make a big deal out of it. It wasn't, and we've got a female representative. It was actually, it's just another person, another pundit, you know?
And why would they make a difference, or why should they interpret that there's a difference?
Absolutely. You know? Yeah, they're probably, I would assume they're probably more successful, in all fairness.
No comment, Your Honour.
back to the Lionesses, they absolutely are paving the way for the female game, right?
Absolutely. And as I say, they are empowering the youngsters. The youngsters see them and they've got something to aspire to. And it's not just the football that they're being taught lessons. You know, it's life lessons. It's about discipline. It's about routine. It's about going out there. It's having the winning attitude. It's having the attitude that if they lose, how do they deal with that? Disappointments in life. So it's not just about football. It's not just about kicking a ball.
Yeah.
There's other lessons as well that we teach our girls. And surely, you know, the Lionesses have done that tremendously for us and represented as well.
Absolutely. And everybody starts at grassroots, right? You don't start as a professional player. So let's talk about then, you know, how to grow it. Because the Total Grassroots Football Podcast is all about a knowledge share, right? We want to help other female clubs and female teams in their little corner, right? And I think there's three key issues. One is actually participation. Then you'd probably look at volunteering, and then fundamentally there's funding as well, right? So how, you guys are obviously very successful. How do you guys help with the participation? How do you get players in, regardless of funding, let's say, but how do you get, you know, parents involved? How do you get, you know, actual girls playing? You know, have you got a secret that you don't want to say or do want to say?
You mean, have I got the Midas touch? No, I don't have the Midas touch. But what I do say to every single member of our club, it's not an autocratic decision. We have an exec board that ultimately will have that overarching management decision making. But ultimately, the club is for the members. So any member can come to us with any ideas, any support, and we'll look at it as a club. And we think if it's a really good idea, we'll share that, we'll do a pilot. And then if it's worthwhile, we'll roll that out. You know, we evaluate everything. But the key thing is, you know, to get your volunteers, which are usually your adults, you definitely need to get that influx of young girls.
Young girls as volunteers?
We do have some young girls as volunteers because we're very fortunate that we're partnered with Sky Blues in the community, which is the charity arm of Coventry City Football Club.
Right.
So these young girls are helping and supporting for match days. So there'll be match ball girls, or whatever you call them. I think you used to call them ball boys in the day.
Match ball people, I think maybe. Yeah,
whatever the phrase is these days. But then also flag bearers. So, you know, welcoming the players onto the pitch. The girls are there standing and waving their flags, which is absolutely fantastic. And an incredible experience for the girls as well. So we do like they've got the cute factor for the younger players.
Yeah, do you know? Yeah, absolutely. And I think actually it's not just players, now that you mention that, right? It's representation across the board. It's a, seeing girls as referees. And as volunteers, and seeing girls as referees in professional matches. I know this is, we're talking grassroots, but actually the accessibility and the visibility of women in a quote unquote men's game does wonders for the women's game, right?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And that's something else that we do support our girls with. So when they reach that age, I think it's usually 16, we then support them. So if they want to go off and do a referees course, if they want to do a level one course and then give back their training and their skills that they've learned back into a junior age section, which we've got quite a few of our under 18s that participate in that.
Right.
And again, it's that pathway to show these young ladies that you can start as young as 9 and you can play for Coventry City Girls all the way through the ages, right up through to senior team, which is where my daughter started, which is where I got involved.
Yeah. And do you, you obviously support that development, right? That you, you actually, once they're at the end of that pathway of actually playing that game, you then try and get them to kind of give back and feed that cycle, right?
Absolutely. And it's never too old to start that cycle.
Yeah. Would you put that as a key thing in your success, is to actually try and feed that talent back into the game again? Because I think you're right. I think even with the boys team, you know, once they get to finishing that grassroots club, it's either they're really good and they really focus on it, or then it just drop off and then they go and find girls, right? So I think it's, you know, is it a matter of trying to develop and trying to hone those kids back into the game?
Yes, and we've looked at it a different angle as well. So we've got a company, Aspire to Be, that we also work alongside. It's headed up by a lady called Hayley Griffiths, who used to be one of our senior players within our first team. And she comes along to the age groups of 15s and 16s, and she talks about them taking football to a different level, and also offering the, you know, the facilities to play football, but also make sure that they've still got a qualification and an education behind them.
Right.
So they have their own team that they play, but then they don't prevent the girls from playing within our club. So we work connectively together.
Yeah. Do you need
to make sure that support there?
Yeah, I love it. Do you need more players? Like, are you, could you do with more kids coming and joining in, or are you full?
We're not full. And next year we've got more opportunity to expand the teams even further.
Great.
But one of the challenges that you were talking about earlier, you know, what's the frustration, is our facilities. There are not enough football pitches around, and there's certainly not enough training facilities. And one of the key things that I've been really proud of is that the girls can see all the way through the age group, the training sessions as they go through the age groups. So again, it's given that continuity to, and the confidence to the girls to say, you're starting here, but you're going to end here.
Sure.
So the only way that we can grow currently is by splitting our training night up.
Right.
And again, that impacts massively because they're volunteers. So for the under-18s, for example, you might get them training on a Wednesday. You may get them coaching on a Thursday, but then they're also facilitating matches on a Saturday and a Sunday.
Yeah, all of a sudden so, it's full time, right?
Absolutely. And if they're studying for their A-levels as well, we have to make sure that that takes priority.
Absolutely. And how do you go about finding these players? Because there's probably an element of push rather than pull, I think, for females getting into football.
I think that a lot of our recruitment has come from word of mouth and the fact that they see ourselves with the badge as being a professional outfit.
Yeah.
And yes, we are a professional outfit. Don't get me wrong, there are tweaks that can be made to any club, any organisation. But in terms of how these girls come to us, 9 times out of 10, it's usually a friend from school. You know, they go to school, they show the awards that they've won, they show the trophies, look what I've got. And all of a sudden, you're creating that interest. We've also got people like Soccer Rocks, for example, that are a small network that coach and encourage female football as well as boys football, and they need somewhere to feed into, so they're also feeding into us as well.
That's great.
And again, Sky Blues in the community, they have a Saturday morning community session, so if there's any girls that pop along there that want to join a team and want to play football, then again we get recruitments from there. We've also got posters, and social media is absolutely immense, you know, your Twitter pages, your Facebook, your Instagrams, and we put out there when we're having our trials, and we usually do it over a 3-week period. And then anybody that we're unsure about, we'll invite for further training sessions. But it's the league that puts stipulations. We have to have a team registered by the 1st of August. So that's why you sort of finish one season before you start the next. And the girls don't get really much of a break. But that is also good if they're going from finishing training to then trial in for the next season.
Yeah, that's right. You just keep them on that conveyor belt, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And what about funding? You know, do you have sponsors? Have you, is it tougher, do you feel, for the women's game to kind of pull in funding at grassroots level?
When you're looking at funding, I see this in two sort of elements. So funding predominantly and support from the FA would be great. There's been lots of grants that they've issued out there, but unfortunately we've not been successful in securing lots of the grants, but we've had a lot of the small grants.
You say we, meaning Coventry City Girls.
Coventry City, yes, absolutely.
Right.
Yeah, and the other thing, Gary, is we don't have anybody that's full-time, and I don't mean this in a derogatory or disrespectful way, but the buzzwords of how to complete the forms, you know, there's a format that needs to be completed, and if you don't tick the boxes or know the buzzwords, sometimes you may well be sifted on the first shed, so to speak. Oh, okay,
so you think it's almost a political part to it, or an administrative challenge?
I wouldn't say it's political, I'd say it's an administrative challenge.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just basically for the time that it takes to complete that form, understanding the guide, understanding the deadlines and making sure that we hit all those parameters and some details we don't always have.
Yeah.
But going back to the sponsorship, we have been absolutely amazed by the sponsorship opportunities that we've got coming through this year and certainly for the seasons that we've had before.
Great.
Why do you think
that is then?
A lot of it is because we've been very lucky that people within the teams have got parents that have their own business, so therefore they're sponsoring in their individual capacity. Or we've had larger companies that have come forward and said, you know, we really want to put back into the community. We want to see that we're supporting the community and how can we do that? And then they sponsor various different garments, which with the night deal, brilliant. We can actually extend the range.
Absolutely. And I think that, you know, that might be down to a little bit of the rise in equality, or the focus of rising in equality, be sponsoring the girls team. But I think it is about community. You know, I think you can quite easily go out to the community and say, hey, who wants to be a part of it? And also find the type of sponsor, because it's not just about a logo on a jersey, right? Although that is a good starting point. It starts off a good conversation. You know, you might be getting the local, you know, greengrocer, for example, you know, obviously when it's not in the Victorian age, but you know, get the local greengrocer, but then he can obviously supply oranges at half time, you know.
Absolutely. And you know, we've got pharmacists that are sponsoring us, so again we've got an opportunity to replenish the first aid stock, and we're very lucky because we've got, as I say, the parents that own their own business, they're putting back into the girls and the sponsorship, but we're also, every time we're tweeting or Instagramming about the particular team, then we make sure that we always put the company's logo on there, so giving them exposure.
Yes.
We've then also got our webpage, so we make sure that the sponsor's logo is on our webpage, and if they click on that, that would take them directly through to that company's webpage, so they can find various different things. So it's making sure that you actually give back to the sponsor.
Absolutely. And
agree what they want. We're not greedy. We've got some really reasonable packages, you know, from £500 to sponsor girls' football shirts for a season.
I mean, that's an absolute bargain, really, if you think the amount of the exposure, but also the amount of storytelling that you can get off the back of that as well, right?
Yeah.
And I think what you could do, or, you know, storytelling for the sponsor, what there are so many things that I think a club can do, because there's not just the logo on the jersey, like I said, or the billboard on the side of the pitch. You know, there's a lot of real estate there. And actually what clubs and teams should really look at is see themselves as almost a media company, right? You know, obviously there's a safeguarding element, but you could create videos and sell those videos to a sponsor. So let's say you did top 10 drills for the female game, you know, the 10 little 1 minute videos, and actually you can get Joe Blogs Limited from the High Street to buy those videos so they can then exclusively post it over their social, you know, because that everybody needs more content. So if you can create content using the players, everyone's a winner, right?
Absolutely. Gary, I think you've just taught yourself in being our next volunteer for our media officer.
I can absolutely help. I will be there with bells on.
Brilliant. Fabulous.
Yeah. So, hey, look, it's been great speaking to you. How can people get in touch? How can they, you know, send their daughters down to Coventry City Girls?
So they can either phone myself, or if they go onto the website of Coventry City Girls Football Club, there is a contact button. And if they click on the contact button, put their details in, and then we can respond to any emails that come through. But please make sure it's an adult that's filling in this form, not a 14, 15, 16-year-old child.
Good. That's a great tip there. Absolutely. So kids, if you're listening, don't do it yourself. Get mum and dad for it. Get the bill payers' permission.
Yeah, I love it. That's exactly it. Get the bill payers' permission. Yeah.
Hey, look, thanks very much, Laina, from Coventry City Girls. Listeners, thanks very much for tuning in to the Vesey Total Grassroots Football Podcast.